Our next presenter is Robert Van Rens from Cornell University. My apologies if I pronounced your name wrong. Tamper-proof provenance-aware storage for mobile ad hoc networks.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. So this is actually a joint work with Danny Adams, Guar, Ruben Bisa, Xinwen Wang, and Hakeem Wetherspoon at Cornell University. None of them could make it today, so I'm the lucky one to present this talk, and I'm happy about it. Let me see if I can. Yes, there we go. So the main idea is actually similar to what we've heard from Martin, and actually also related to what Victor was talking about before that. Want to support decentralized applications in an ad hoc mobile network when there's no reliable network infrastructure, no reliable power source. So settings like these occur like in emergency response when maybe the internet goes out, digital agriculture types of applications, and application we're looking at right now on farms, and in general the Internet of Things. And so for example, might have an application where you have a medic that needs to have access to medical records but want to be privacy aware, so we don't want the medic to just look at any particular record that he or she or they want to look at, but somehow provide secure access. Of course, when the network is down, that's tricky. And so one thing we do is provide accountability by logging any request in a tamper-proof log, then provide that record from some database that should be stored on the medic's device, but not usually accessible until that request is logged. And then after an emergency is over, these logs may be reviewed. But how do we implement these tamper-proof logs? In an ad hoc network, there might not be access to the cloud or the internet. Not all nodes may be trusted. Traditional blockchains might, sound like an option, but they're not really, because they tend to be quite compute intensive, particularly if they use proof of work or something like that, or proof of some resource. And also they require high network connectivity. So miners typically need to broadcast their blocks as quickly as possible to all the participants. But in our situation, nodes may be disconnected from the network, or there may be significant network partitions. And also, all this wasted work from creating blocks that they're then later pruned can lead to significant security issues. So then there's, the whole area of permission blockchains, which don't need proof of resource. They're based on voting and secure certificates and maybe other crypto techniques. But we cannot do majority voting when there is no network. So that's not really an option either. And so we've been looking at a structure that allows branching. So Vegvísir is the name of our project. It's Icelandic for wayfinder. And in our case, we have a directed acyclic graph of blocks instead of a linear chain of blocks. So this DAG maintains a full causal history of events, but it's maybe not super appropriate for like cryptocurrencies, and that's not really what we designed it for in the first place. So we do want some important properties. We do like in a normal blockchain, we want that if a block is added, that you cannot remove it later. Right? We want to use it for accountability, like in that example. We cannot have blocks once added disappearing. And for integrity, we also, that's pretty simple. Each block is actually going to be signed by an authorized principal. So if a node is correct, here's a picture with maybe four nodes, blue, green, yellow, and red, that add blocks to the blockchain. They each sign their blocks. If a node is correct, they always need end to what they think is the end of the blockchain. And so it should never be the case that blocks from the same node should be on different paths in this DAG. because that means they would add them to concurrent paths in this DAG. So this is a, you know, here's an example of a valid DAG. But if you, for example, have this situation where the red node has created blocks on different branches of this different paths in this DAG, concurrent paths in this DAG, then that's a proof of misbehavior. In order to make sure the blocks don't disappear, we have also something called a proof of witness that can take on many forms. It's so, for example, proof of witness may be that, you know, at least K plus one nodes have seen a block. And that would protect you against a situation where there are K malicious nodes that then, you know, remove the block from the blockchain. So a block will survive if there are more than K, what we call witnesses. So different applications can use different policies as far as that is concerned, similar to, you know, like how many blocks or how much a block needs to be buried in the Bitcoin blockchain. But basically it's, yes, it's application dependent. And once a block is witnessed, all its ancestor blocks are also witnessed. So there is a good research question around, you know, what really makes a good witness in this case? And I'm not going to answer that right now. So when you have a DAG like this, you can count how many devices have seen a particular block. And I've labeled them here. You know, the leftmost block can be seen by all four devices, whereas the rightmost block at the moment only be seen by one device, the red device. So you can count how many witnesses a block has, and based on that, you can set a policy on whether you trust the data in the block or not, or trust it to to persist. So the different devices may have different views of what this block DAG looks like, and so they're going to gossip with one another opportunistically. When two devices aren't within communication range, they're going to try and reconcile their block DAGs, much in the same way that Martin just described. And we have very similar protocols with Bloom filters and actually a few others that we've tried out in order for devices to efficiently merge their DAGs here. There's three DAGs on the left that are then merged into the DAG on the right. When those, say those three devices are in contact with one another. I have on the left, if you could, it's a little hard to see those dashed boxes. Those are the blocks that are the same. The other blocks are unique. And then, you know, when you merge them, you end up with the DAG on the right. And here on the right also, there's a new block added that is a width so that the green device has witnessed all those three versions of the blockchain and merged them. Okay, but it's a DAG. So we have a little bit of a problem. It's not a chain. In a chain, you know, if you have sequential, some kind of sequential specification of what your operations do, you can compute what the state is. How does that work in VecVisor? People have mentioned it over and over again in this session, but we're using CRDTs. So CRDTs require that, you know, concurrent updates commute essentially. It's a little more complicated than that, but that's the basic idea. So it allows separate nodes to be updated independently, and then when these reconciliations happen, we can come up with a semantics for what the merged state is. So here's an example of a CRDT, a 2P set, which is a set from which you can add elements to it, you can remove elements to it, but removes win over add. If you remove something, it can never be added back in. So the state of the 2P set is the add set minus the remove set. When you put that in VecVisor, you actually get this graph of these 2P sets, and then you can actually do a little better. That is, concurrent removes win over adds. But if somebody adds causally after a remove, then, you know, that add will actually win over the remove. So you can add things back in. So we have add and remove. And with a well-defined semantics, set semantics that makes sense in the system. So just a few words about VecVisor itself. So it's the blockchain, and then there's a state machine that's similar to the EVM, I guess, but it operates on CRDTs. And the operations are applied to the state machine once there is a satisfactory proof of witness. We have a special 2P Plus stand that maintains membership in the in this system, so you can add members. And this is on a per CRDT basis usually, so you can tell, you know, you can add members to do certain operations on a CRDT or remove them. And this is a more or less a capability-based system. Some other nice properties. So yes, you get acyclic growth. We can limit branching. So the DAG is more or less, you know, it's pretty thin. That's because of the proof of misbehaviors. We do temper proofing using the proof of witnesses. We also have a checkpointing system. You can read about that in the paper. And I have a draft of a newer paper if you're interested that we submitted to this conference. And then there's also a rate limiting protocol in place to deal at least partially with denial of service attacks. And so that's where I'll conclude. So, I think dovetails very well with the two prior talks you heard about. It's VecVisor is a blockchain-like system works in network constrained environments where there may be partitions. It's not there. We didn't introduce a DAG in order to get high throughput like some other blockchain systems. We introduced the DAG because we wanted to allow for partitioned operation. That's the only reason we have a DAG. We have the proof of witness and proof of misbehavior, causal CRDTs that give you nice semantics over the data that's in VecVisor. And we have a prototype available if you want to experiment with it. It runs on Android devices. That's where I'll stop.